Gentlemen, thanks for joining us today.
Sure, thanks.
I'd like to talk a bit about Convalo Health International. What is the value proposition for investors? What does the future hold, and what's the business model?
Well, it's a roll-up of the U.S. Addiction center market. Mm-hmm. There's some new legislation that has come to pass in the last couple of years that basically creates an opportunity for anyone in the United States who has addiction issues to get insurance-reimbursed addiction rehabilitation. So there's about 300 million people in the United States. Statistically, about 10% of them suffer from addiction issues. Maybe not surprisingly, only about 10% of those people actually seek treatment. That's still 3 million people in the United States.
Sure.
So 3 million people in the United States by law have to be covered by insurance for addiction services. 10 years ago, there were only about 300,000 people that could seek addiction services at places like Malibu, very expensive places. But this new reimbursement code basically has opened up the market. So it's a very fragmented market, a very new market. There's only about 16,000 of these centers in the United States. Now, the reason I say only about 16,000, most of them only have 20 or 30 beds or chairs, depending on whether they're inpatient or outpatient. So if you do that math, there's less than 800,000 total seats or beds available for the 3 million people looking. So we've come in as institutional money to basically roll that up. I think we have a very unique model to be able to compete.
How does your offering differentiate itself from what's already available?
Go ahead, Roger.
Well, and by the way, I do want to add that, you know, this legislative change was really mandated by a U.S. Supreme Court decision. So it's not, just so everyone's clear, it's not something associated with Obamacare. There was a U.S. Supreme Court decision and the legislative change implemented
it. So it won't be rescinded.
It's not going away anytime soon. One thing I do want to say about Convalo and the, for example, the first centers we've opened at Boulevard, they offer outpatient services that I think are very different than the standard services offered. Well, there are additional services. For example, everyone has heard of the 12-step program that's used for addiction rehabilitation. But a lot of young people just don't identify that with that program that was created in the 1930s. It's very heavily steeped in, you know, Christian theology. And that's not true for a lot of folks. So so for these young people, we have different alternative therapies. They can be mindfulness. There are therapies that focus upon different niches, including LGBT niches. And what's happened, I think, in our first acquisitions is that the clients have really liked it. So it's not simply a case that we found a great market. It's also the case that we found young people who really have enjoyed the program. I think, although Michael talks a lot about some of the financial metrics, he sincerely is concerned about what happens to the clients. And our business has mushroomed, I think, because we've gotten great feedback on the services we've provided.
So do you think your different approach has made it accessible? Addiction treatment has become accessible for a range of people that for whom previously it would not be considered because of its 12-step orientation?
Well, I don't know about that. I mean, we offer 12-step still the foundation of what we do.
So you offer everything?
We offer everything.
Okay.
I think there's really what we do is we go acquire little clinically focused businesses. Some of them are clinically focused through 12-step rehabilitation. Others are clinically focused in other types of insurance reimbursed rehabilitation. Everything's insurance reimbursed here. But we add another kind of component, which is a hospitality component. You can imagine if you're young, and most of our clients are quite young, and addiction is usually an illness of youth, because if you're, you know, smoking crack cocaine and you're 50, that is not usually very compatible.
Right.
It's a miracle, exactly. So usually it's under 25, under 28, under 30-year-olds. And they have they enjoy a lifestyle. Usually you're out clubbing in Hollywood or in New York. And when you're done clubbing and that life is not sustainable, you don't want to go into a hospital or into a basement of a church. That doesn't feel sexy. So we offer a hospitality-driven experience where the kids can come in and not just get insurance reimbursed, clinically focused services like 12-step programs, or programs if you're gay, or programs if you're a meditator, or programs if you're Eastern philosophy. There's a lot of ways of getting sober. But we really try to make the experience a cool and interesting and hip experience for kids who are, you know, who are want to be in a place that's cool and hip.
So are you going to bring this model and apply it to a methodology that you've used in the past whereby you issue shares in cash to acquire existing yes. facilities, or are you going to build new facilities?
Well, I think we're really acquiring existing talent, really, and existing marketing talent. That's the most important thing for us. So we'll go into a city. We like the city center approach. Ultimately, the city center approach is important for us. We like to be in the city center in Los Angeles, for example. We'll go make a small acquisition. The one in LA is a great example. We made a small acquisition, about $60,000 a month in sales this company had. 9 months later, it has $600,000 a month in sales. How did we increase? How did we 10x sales?
Right.
Well, we 10x sales by doing a couple of things. First, we took a very small business that was word of mouth, and we institutionalized sales and marketing. So we hired salespeople, we hired marketing people. We created a much more institutional presence for the Hollywood Center than the previous owner had.
Mm-hmm.
We also moved the facility. We only moved it about a half a mile, but we made a much bigger facility. She had a facility that had maybe 12 or 15 people total. We now have a 100-person facility. The other thing is we made it hip and cool. So the people who stayed there used to stay there an average of about 3 weeks. Now our patients are staying there more than 63 days. Our average is higher than 63. So we're getting paid per day for more days. We have more people that we can fit, and we're institutionalizing the sales. So we've gone from about 8 patients to about 60 patients. This is all in less than a year. We have another acquisition in West LA that we've just made. I expect the same thing to happen there. And we're looking at really 5 or 6 cities around the country that we're going to do this in.
Sure.
Now, those are just outpatient centers. We look at a city and we think there's an entire service offering to have in that city. So we'll be making acquisitions of detox centers. We'll be making acquisitions of residential treatment centers. We're already making acquisitions of outpatient centers. We'll make acquisitions of aftercare centers. And much like our other company, Patient Home Monitoring, these are very focused centers that are focused only on one item of the spectrum of treatment. So you'll go and only buy a detox center. All they do is detox. The reality is there's about $100,000 a year per patient to be made here, and you really want to offer detox and residential and outpatient and aftercare to be able to capture the entire kind of cross-selling spectrum. So our plan is to go, again, trailing 12 revenues, trailing 12 profits, buy a multiple of trailing 12s. That multiple is not representative of the total value of the patient or the database, and go basically expand the offering to the patient so that we can capture the full spectrum of revenue.
Sure. Okay, so on an annual basis, how much can you build? How fast can you acquire? How fast can you build and grow revenues?
Roger?
Well, again, you know,
I say really fast, but I'm going to let Roger answer that question.
Let's have a conservative view.
It is a fragmented industry, you know, so I think there are going to be plenty of opportunities, and I think that a lot of the sellers here appreciate the fact, you know, we've shown them that we can really take the services they've provided and really increase the benefits to their patients. A lot of them are concerned about that as well as purchase price. So I think, you know, just looking at LA, I mean, that market is a huge market alone. New York is a huge market. You know, these major cities are just teeming with demand. So I can't give you specifics, but I think there's tons of opportunity.
Okay, so.
Well, I'll give you some specifics.
Okay, well, I'm sure you will.
So I would say, you know, we bought the Hollywood Center a year ago, and we'll have about 1,000% organic growth.
1,000%.
1,000% organic
growth.
Now,
is that sustainable quarter-on-quarter growth?
Well, I don't know if it is.
Okay,
I think
that's a one-time growth.
Perhaps, yeah, I mean, we haven't been in business for longer than a year.
Sure.
In a year, we'll sit here and I'll let
sure.
you know.
But that's the objective.
But that's the objective.
1,000% growth?
1,000% in the first year,
sure.
Right? That's
okay.
Certainly what we've done. I think we can do that in West Hollywood, in West LA as well. In terms of timing, it's difficult to know when you can buy something. That's a challenge for us. But what this company has, which is kind of a little bit different and maybe better than PHM, is it's got very low CapEx. So we recouped 100% of our cash outlay for the first acquisition in 5 months, 100%. And now, and this thing's going to last. You know, we have a 15-year lease there, so for the next 15 years, it's gravy, right?
Yeah.
West LA, in West LA, it's going to be the same situation, I believe. It looks like all the metrics are there. So, we have a little bit of a lower CapEx and higher margins. We have about 30% EBITDA margins in this business. Give us a little bit of comfort that we won't have to run quite as fast or as hard. First of all. It is difficult to buy these businesses because a lot of the owners are recovering addicts and they are not business people, and so it makes it difficult to do a transaction with them. So it might not be as fast moving from an M&A perspective as PHM, but from a torque on capital, it's much more torquey. Right? You've got higher margins, lower CapEx, and way, way higher. PHM is in the double digit figure for organic growth. We're in the triple digit. I'm going to say quadruple in the first year, but I think triple digit is a fair number. And the Hollywood Center, even though it's only doing $6 million a year in revenue now, that can get to $12 million in full capacity.
Sure.
And I think we can get it there in the next year.
Okay, so you're in the enviable position of having launched two successful companies this year on the TSX venture. That PHM has performed many multiples of a percentage gain. Convalo hasn't yet. So there's going to be some questions from the investing audience. They're going to say, well, PHM has gone as far as it can now. I'm going to play Convalo, and then I'm going to wait for the next one because we know that you have other companies of roll-up models coming. So how do you ameliorate that effect by, you know, convincing the investing audience that PHM is going to a billion, Convalo is just getting started, and you're not being overstretched by your multiple corporate commitments?
Well, we do not operate these businesses. We are managers of the managers. So we are ex-private equity guys. So what we do is hold the feet to the fire of the managers. We make sure that they are, on a weekly basis, giving us good metrics. On a monthly basis, we're looking at the financials. We're the architects of these deals. But again, you know, we spend, maybe a day a month now on PHM?
Right.
I mean, very, very little. We have a great banker in Edward Brand in PHM who goes out and buys these companies. He knows exactly what to pay, how to structure. We've taught him to do all of that. The operators know how to scrub the database. In Convalo, it's turning into that. We now know what we're willing to pay, how much organic growth we have, what the churn on capital is. So we're really the architects. We sit on the board, but really we're not operating the business. And a good example of that is there's maybe 700 employees in PHM now after these acquisitions. Roger and I interact with like 7 or 8 of them. And I've personally, frankly, never been to New Hampshire, the Maine acquisition. Or the Virginia acquisition. I haven't gone and seen those. It's not necessary for us. So in the early stages, we are very hands-on in these deals, but within the first 4, 5, 6 months, once we get them established, they're off and going. I do want to make one other point. Your question is, how do you get, how can we sit here and say, well, we're going to get this company to a billion and this company to 300 million? And I just want to remind Canadians particularly, the U.S. healthcare economy is 3 times the size of the entire Canadian economy, right? There's $3.5 trillion spent on healthcare in the United States. So it's not that mind-numbing to think that there might be a couple of billion-dollar companies in the mix.
Right.
And I know that's a little bit odd because in Canada, making money on healthcare is almost impossible. I think that's why we've done so well on the TSX, because there's cash flow in U.S. healthcare. In Canadian healthcare, maybe not so much. And I don't know that they quite understand the size of the market and the growth of the market.
Mm-hmm. Okay, which leads to another interesting point. You're based in California, yet you have chosen to list on the TSX Venture Exchange in Canada. What has been the cause of that, and what are the advantages?
One, I would say, one of our great competitive advantages has been being listed on the TSX Venture Exchange. You know, we could not do what we're doing by being listed on an American exchange. We couldn't acquire these small businesses, raise, what in the U.S. is relatively small amounts of money, get attention. No one would be interviewing us if we were a $250 million company on the NASDAQ. In addition, it's been a great exchange for us as we try to buy companies. One of the things they've looked at is the volume in our stock, for example. Sellers who are taking stock are very excited about the notion that we have a liquid stock, because they know someday when they want to, they can get out. It's not trading by appointment. So it's been favorable for us.
Sure. Okay. Now, what are the events that are going to occur in the future that would represent milestones that investors could say, okay, there's a sign that there's value appreciation coming? What are the key developments we should look for?
Well, acquisitions, always acquisitions. I mean, we look at our deals, we're acquisition-oriented guys. So an acquisition, a letter of intent, I like to think quarterly financials. Those are my favorite catalysts for share price, right? You look at PHM, we've doubled in the last year, EPS. Convalo, it's interesting because, PHM has $100 million in cash, and it's kind of a juggernaut. That thing's going to a billion. I think there's no doubt about that. 18 months ago, it was a different story. 18 months ago, Roger and I put our own money into this thing. Now, it wasn't so much a gamble for us, because for 12 years we've been in healthcare services. But for a lot of the other people around us, they looked at us and thought, oh my goodness, is this gonna happen? And we only had a couple $1 million in cash, and it was mostly our money to be able to do these deals with PHM. Convalo now sits in a kind of interesting place. It's 18 months behind PHM, but it has $30 million in cash, not three. right? And it has much more organic growth, and we know that it works, right? We've seen it now for a year get to 1,000% growth rate. So Convalo is kind of an, you know, we've taken, sadly, maybe for all of us, all of the lessons from PHM and the shareholders who've had to endure those lessons, we've been able to apply now to Convalo. We're applying to Inspira, which is our next deal. So as we bring more deals out, there's tons and tons of ways to make money on the U.S. in U.S. healthcare. And it's mostly in the cottage industry. It's in these little segments where you couldn't do this on a U.S. exchange. So the Canadian exchange is really an important concept to us because we can do little bits of money. Convalo is a good example. $30 million is not a lot of money to roll up a $40 billion industry. Right. But we can do it in the specific way that we want to, in the big cities with small businesses, adding this kind of hospitality angle. We can turn $30 million into $300 or $400 million in a couple of years. Because we are listed on the Canadian exchange.
Okay, so then how do investors keep track of where you're going next?
Well, I mean, they just need to call you, James. or right. Alternatively, they could just read our press releases and look at our financial statements. And ultimately, I think, you know, we are starting to get fairly well known in Canada, at least in the venture space. And you know, we're pretty transparent guys. I mean, that's something that we bring from a more of a NASDAQ background, more of a private equity background. We're happy to talk about what works and what doesn't work and what the risks are. We're also happy to put our own money into these deals. I think that's, I've been told, rare in Canada.
Sure.
So ultimately, you know, we will just be out there letting people know what we're up to, and we'll keep you, you'll know first.
Okay, great, thanks. Well, let's leave it there, gentlemen. Thanks for joining us today.
Sure, thank you.